what about others? He saved you, he saved me. What are we doing for others? Do you believe in dreams, the Holy Spirit's dreams? Thousands of men running down the streets. They didn't know that the road was leading to a steep and deadly cliff and into the lake of fire. Others, whoa, he saved you, he saved me. What are we doing? Oh, for others, multitudes, multitudes are waiting. In the valley of decision, oh yes, they are waiting, they're hoping to hear the gospel. They don't know Jesus Christ, they are lost and dying souls. Oh, he saved you, he saved me. He saved us for all time, but what about others? Oh, he saved you, he saved me. What are we doing? Oh, for others. Why do we sit and wait while millions go to hell? Their blood is on our hands. It's time to preach the word. Oh yes, the gospel of Jesus in its pure and simple form is what is missing now in the church. What are we preaching? He saved us for all times, but what about others? Oh, he saved you and he saved me. What are we doing? Oh, for others. We are salt of the world, light of the world. Are we really shining? Shining like we should. We are the salt of the world and the light of the world. Are we really shining as the light of the world? He saved you and he saved me. Yes, he did. He saved us for all times. But what about others? What about others? He saved you and he saved me. What are we doing? Oh, for others. And what are we doing for the others?
serving in your house, Lord, doing your will. I don't want to be one of those who leave you, those who pretend around you, those who forsake you.
Can't hear me. Hallelujah. Amen. Isaiah chapter 12 verse 3. With joy will you draw out of the wells of salvation. How many of you are expecting to receive a testimony next week? Then you have to stand to your feet and give the Lord a shout of praise. The most excited, the most happy person here is the next person receiving a testimony. With joy, you will draw from the wells of salvation. Do you believe it? Then shout, Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Our first testimony is coming from our brother Christopher from Lagos. Put your hands together for him. Oh, do it better for him. Christopher, tell us, what has God done for you?
I'm here to thank God about a miracle laptop I received after sowing a seed on the Healing Jesus. Yeah.
On the Healing Jesus Sunday.
Yeah.
You received a miracle laptop.
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
So 2 months ago, I'm a natural science student. And 2 months ago, I decided to minor in computer science, which means I'll take certain courses involving the use of the laptop, which I didn't have at that time. A week or two was the Healing Jesus Day. And after Pastor Reverend Joshua preached, they played a video for us. And he gave us a chance to sow a seed. And I used this as an opportunity to sow a seed into my laptop. A week or two later, my dad called me and asked me if I had contacted his manager.
Your dad called you?
Yeah.
And asked you if you had contacted his manager
concerning any laptop. And I was like, no, I don't even have her number. And he ended the call. I was waiting a week past, 2 weeks. On a Wednesday, I was very busy, so I didn't use my phone all day.
In the evening?
Yeah, in the evening.
Because you didn't use it all day.
Yeah, in the evening, when I took my phone, I saw a lot of missed calls from my mom. And I returned her call, and she was like, somebody just brought a parcel with a laptop in it.
Wow.
Yeah, and I knew that it is because of the seed I sold.
Who brought the laptop?
The manager sent someone.
Your dad's manager
sent someone to
bring the laptop.
Yeah.
But you haven't mentioned to me.
I don't even talk to you. I don't have a number.
Wow. Yeah. God is sending somebody to supernaturally bring something that you need this week. The Bible says, give shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, men will give unto your bosom. So you believe in sowing?
Yes, and I urge everyone to use that opportunity. You may not know. It's good to sow in every church, especially this church.
Wow, yeah. Put your hands together for that powerful testimony. And we'll take our last testimony from Collins Darko. He's an uncle. Collins, tell us, what has God done for you?
I thank God for a financial blessing I received after paying my tithe.
You received a financial blessing?
Yes.
After paying your tithe?
Yes.
Tell us about it.
Usually, I pay my tithe every week as and when I receive it. But some few weeks ago, by the time I got to church, I was only left with my tithe and my transportation to go back home. But I also wanted to reduce my busing cost with that same money. So I was contemplating. In the end, I didn't pay the tithe because I felt like, oh, God understands. So I'll just pay it the next week because I was expecting...
You borrowed from your tithe?
Yes. I was expecting money from two people during the week. So I said, oh, when it comes, I'll pay the arrears and also pay for that one also.
And what happened that week?
So throughout the week, I was very expectant, but none of the monies came. And I was so surprised. So... by the end of the week, I regretted not paying the tithe. I felt like it was because I didn't pay. That monies I knew for sure that were coming, they didn't come. So I had some money in my custody that I was supposed to use to make some payments. But I decided to take from it and pay the arrears I was owing. So on Sunday...
The Bible says, will a man rob God? Some people have robbed God for a long time. So you took and you paid your tithe?
Yes, so I paid my tithe and the prophets prayed for us. So during the week, I received money from one of the people I was expecting and from two other people I wasn't expecting. And one of them, it was so surprising because it was my director where I did my national service. My boss, she called me and she told me, oh, she had some money for me from some work I had done on their behalf whilst I was doing my national service. And I was surprised because I'm talking about a government institution. And it doesn't happen like that. It's not like there are no reward schemes or things of that sort. So it was like she called me personally and she could have just told the secretary or something. They are very busy and I don't know. But I believe that because I paid my tithe, all those monies came. And if I didn't pay, I may not have received. Amen. And I've been analyzing and I noticed that some of us, we feel like, oh, I'm saving my tithe. I'm keeping it till the end of the month. Then I'll pay all once. But I don't know if it works. I don't know if you're able to faithfully pay the whole amount. But I feel instead of doing that and paying once in the whole month and be prayed for once, I would rather prefer that the smallest amount I get every week, I pay for that and be blessed and be prayed for that week. So by the end of the month, I would have been prayed for like 3 or 4 times.
I'll give the Lord a shout of praise. The windows are opening over you. God is sending you a blessing. Put your hands together for that powerful testimony.
Hallelujah. Wave your hands if you are blessed to be in the house of God this afternoon. Amen. Lift your hands and let's pray for 2 seconds and ask God to guide us by His word, that His word will not return to Him void, but will prosper in what He sent it to do. Amen. Lift your hands and pray, Lord, speak to me today. Speak by your Spirit. Lift your hands, begin to pray. Ask the Lord to give you a heart of flesh. Take away my stony heart. Take away stubbornness. Take away resistance to the word. And change me. Change me. Sanctify me by your truth. Thy word is truth. Lift your hands and pray. Say, Lord, speak to me by your Spirit. Guide me. Change me. Everybody, lift your hands. Everybody, lift your hands and pray. Say, Lord, change me by your word. Libra Rada, TKK Santa, Chimele Kininos, Mayango Sakata, Chimele Brandos, Tibli Landasa, Chaki Landos.
Every time that we are gathered together in His name, there He is also in power.
Top again. Every time we are gathered.
Every time that we are
everybody
gathered,
singing together in His name.
Together in His name.
There He is also,
in power and in strength.
Everyone lift your voices and sing.
Let us continually offer
our sacrifice to Him.
Lifting of our hands, He has been sacrificed.
more.
Said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Thank you, oh God, that today we are about to hear your word. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your name that is powerful in our midst. Thank you that today the world will hear your gospel and your word. Thank you that we will all be changed by the word that you are sending to us today. Thank you for the mantle and the gift on our father, the prophet, the man of God of this house who you have ordained for us. I pray for every hand lifted, every ear listening, every heart expecting the word that you have for us. Let that mantle bring that word. Let that gift bring that word and change us and transform us in the name of Jesus. We thank you for your mercy, for washing away our sins, for making us come before you boldly but humbly, for grace and for help in time of need. I thank you that you are with us this afternoon. Let your will be done. In Jesus' name I pray, and everyone said, amen. Put your hands together like you are in First Love Church, and you may be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I can't hear you. Hallelujah. I still can't hear you. Hallelujah. Beautiful. Today, unfortunately, the prophet of this house is not here. But I believe he's with us in spirit, and I know his heart is very much with us. And I know yesterday he called me, and as we were speaking on the phone, he began to intercede for the church. And I believe his mind and his heart and his spirit is always with us, his children, and for that we are blessed. Amen. He's currently in Tanzania. He's preaching for a friend of the ministry, Pastor Apostle Ranwell, I believe his name is. I think it's the largest church in Tanzania. And from there, he's conducting 3 days of crusades in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania. And I saw somebody sandals stepping off a plane into Dar es Salaam. You'll be there in Jesus' name. And he's doing exactly what Jesus said we should do. He's going into all the world, preaching the gospel, healing the sick, casting out devils, and making disciples all the way in Dar es Salaam. Amen. And I believe he is with us in spirit, and we are going to be blessed. Amen. So, oh, are you alive today? You feel? I don't know why you feel sleepy. Touch two people and say, come alive. Amen. Now, if you sit next to somebody who never says amen, who never says preach, who never says wow, who never stands up, you are sitting next to a bad person. So shake that person and say, you are stony ground. You are stony ground. Why? Amen. You may be seated. Today for a few minutes, we have so many other things to do today. So for a few minutes, we're going to share on from our Father's book, how you can be in the perfect will of God. And particularly, we'll be looking at peace, the umpire. Peace, the umpire. Amen. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Everybody say reasonable service. Reasonable. Now, God wants you to be reasonable about your service to Him. Amen. I was once bargaining with the manager of a place, and I was bargaining for a price. And when I mentioned a certain price, he stood up and said, "This meeting is over because you are being unreasonable." He said, I am doing my best for you, but you are now being unreasonable. So sometimes what we offer God is not reasonable. Some of you, your sins needed more of the blood of Jesus than other people to wash. You alone, you used a number of pints to wash your sins away. And some of you bath with it every morning. You know? So when God looks at what He's done for you, He expects a reasonable service or a reasonable response to the good things which He has done for you. Can I have an amen or? Amen. What's wrong with you people today? Are you asleep? I don't know. Or am I in the wrong church? So God expects reasonable service from us. Now, the Apostle Paul said he serves God extra. He said, I serve God. I don't come behind in any of the apostles because I was a sinner and I used to persecute the Christians. So I'm not worthy to even be called an apostle. So when you find out that God has done a lot of great things for you, you need to respond with reasonable service. Do you understand? Yeah, so the things you used to do and sometimes you are still doing alone should even advise you that you should be the most serious chorister. It's only reasonable. But after you find people, after all that God has done for them, they do not even come to church. So God wants from us reasonable service. Can I have an amen? Amen. Wonderful. Now, verse 2 is the verse we want to look at. It says, verse 2, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing. Say, by the renewing of your mind. Your life will change when your mind changes. Amen. Look at it. You will be transformed when your mind is renewed. So when God changes your mind, He changes you. Somebody who can't change their mind is somebody who cannot change. So God wants to that word transform is a metamorphosis, which means to transform from a worm into a butterfly. That's the same word, metamorphosis. If you did general science, basic. From a larvae into a butterfly. So you can, your life can transform from being a worm into being a colorful butterfly when your mind changes. That's how much God can change you. And it's the word of God that transforms and changes us. So now he says, when your mind is changed, what are you going to do? You're going to prove what is the good. Are you looking at the verse? Yes. Not everything I say is useless. Only what's in the Bible that's important. So look at the verse. It says that you prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So God has a will for you, a perfect one. When you are a Christian, you have three options. You can either be outside the will of God, you can be in the imperfect will of God, and then you can be in the perfect will of God. The imperfect will of God is like Novdek. It's not the best, but we accept it. Or? Yeah. So that's like, God permits and allows a lot of things. Or you don't understand? Yeah, I heard someone saying that he wanted his daughter to be a lawyer. And she said, no, she's going to be a seamstress. And he was telling the person, what can I say? I have to pay the school fees. I can't say it. So even your parents have an imperfect will. Like, I wouldn't choose for him to be a seamstress, for her to be a seamstress. But if that's what she wants, I'll pay for. I have no choice but to pay the school fees for the same. Some of you, the courses you are doing, that's not what your parents wanted. But that's called the imperfect will of God. So you have to understand that God also has what He really wants and then what He's allowing you to do. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So for every sphere and area of our lives and in every decision, God has a perfect will, an imperfect will, and out of the will of God. That one is not His will. Now, when before you become a Christian, some of the things are clear. For example, I do counseling sometimes. I'm yet to be asked by a church member that, PJ, so I was confused. Should I do weed or cocaine? I couldn't decide which of them. That's not the decision that we have to make. Or I was deciding whether I should fornicate or not. So I wanted to get your perspective. No, that's black and white. That one is, fornication is out of the will of God. The Bible says this is the will of God, that you be sanctified and that you avoid fornication. It's in the Bible. It's the will of God. It's very clear. So nobody asked those questions. Should I smoke? I wasn't sure. Should I kill him or I should leave him alone? Those ones are easy. Are you with me? They're easy to know. But then after you become a Christian for some time, then you get a real difficult questions. Should I live in London or I should live in Accra? Should I go to Lagos or I should go to UPSA? For the sake of the will of God, for the sake of the gospel, for the will of God, what should I do? Should I marry this girl or I should marry that girl? Both are in church. Both speak in tongues. One is in the choir, one is in the dancing stars. So which one? Do I want somebody who sings at home or somebody who shakes at home? Which one am I looking for? Those one, that is a more complex question than should I fornicate or should I? No, that one is very easy. Should I read my Bible or not? When I woke up, I was trying to decide whether God wants me to read my Bible. I can tell you for a fact, God wants us to read our Bibles day and night, Joshua 1:8. Normal. So that is clear. But when you go on in life, you must become more aware that God has a purpose for you and God has a will. And it says that when your mind is changed, because when you are saved, your mind is renewed. And when your mind is renewed, you are able to prove or to discern what God really wants for you. Because it's good to live anywhere. Everybody can live anywhere. It's good, I tell you, it's good to be in England. If you are in England and you get sick. You know, recently somebody got sick. And I was looking at the prices of healthcare in Ghana. And I said, my goodness. I mean, if you fall sick, you may easily. That's why we do healing service. Because if not, you can easily die. The price that they give you. And surgery is so expensive in Ghana. So living in England, when you fall sick, you walk to the doctor. It's free. National Health Service. We have National NHIS. My goodness, I think it's a little different. Yeah, it's not the service and insurance. So it's better to live there if it's about healthcare. But what are you? Who are you trying to impress? In life, you always have three people that you can impress. Number one, those around you. You can live your life to impress those around you. Recently, I was driving with somebody and he pointed and said, before he dies, God has to give him a Land Cruiser. So I asked him, have you ever sat in a Land Cruiser before to even know? He said, no. From the outside, it's enough. So you see, it means that the only reason why he wants to drive a Land Cruiser is to impress those around, not the inside. Because he's never been inside to know how he will actually feel. One day, a pastor was preaching, he said that he was driving on the motorway. He saw another same model of his car. And then the person indicated and switched lanes. He said, oh, the car was so beautiful. And I never knew how beautiful my car was. Because when you are inside the car, you never actually experience the car from outside. Are you getting me? So you can live your life to impress everybody around. That's number one. Number two, you can live your life to impress yourself. Like whatever I like, I do it. Whatever desires I have, I go for it. And then number three, you can impress God. Now, in 1 John 2:17, the Bible says, the world will pass away. Look at the world, those around, they will go. And the last, that's the things you like. Also will also go away. But those who do the will of God abide forever. When you choose to please God, you'll be around for a long time. A long time. But it's not so easy to know what exactly God wants for you. But I promise you that God wants something for you. You know, one of my surprises is when I was once sitting here, I mean, this is about 2 years ago, and I heard prophets saying that it's a blessing for his son to be in ministry. But I didn't know that that's what he wanted. Just like, it's up to you. But he has a will. Yeah. But that's how a father is. Ah. I know what I want. If you are interested, I know what I want. But you have to search for what the will of the father is. And God is a father. God is a father, and God is a pastor, and God is democratic. So he allows you to choose. We have many instances in the Bible where God just allows people to choose what they want. 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 4. It says, and all the elders gathered to Samuel for a meeting. And they came to Samuel and Ramah. Verse 5. And they asked him, verse 5, and said unto him, your sons are not following you, so make us a king like all the other nations. I said, you can please those around. I want to be like everybody else. This is one of the sources of coming out of the will of God. If I make this girl my beloved, when I'm walking, people will not be impressed. But if I choose this one, Charlie, you force so hey, Charlie, the girl purple, what's up, Charlie, you do well, hey, your girl that, then they'll go to the other face, Charlie, you see the guy and girl, hey, Charlie, but if you see this other one, they'll say, hallelujah. So I want to be like everybody else. Can I have an amen? Verse 6. And the thing displeased Samuel, give us a king. Now, if I was God, immediately I'll kill everybody to remind them who is in charge. Or maybe I'll kill some hundred. Just dead. And I say, no, there's no king except me. I'm the king of kings. That would have been the end of it. But look at what God said in verse 7. Don't listen to the people because they have not rejected you, but they've actually rejected me. Verse 8. According to the works that they have done since I brought them out of Egypt, they have forsaken me and served other gods, and they are doing the same thing to you. 9. So listen to their voice. Give them the king that they want. So now, Saul, you know King Saul, King David, King Solomon, Jeroboam, all the way down to Jesus, is not the will of God. Jesus Christ is not the perfect will of God. Controversial. The perfect will of God was Eden. The Garden of Eden, there was never supposed to be sin. So God was forced to sacrifice his son in an imperfect will that he never wanted. Saul's story, Saul has one of the most beautiful stories about the anointing. It says Saul prophesied with the prophets and he was anointed and he was changed into another man. All those, it's not the will of God. All of Psalms, it's not, gosh, that's not what God wanted. God never wanted a king, never wanted David. But God will supply your disobedience and provide and encourage you to go ahead with it. Oh, you don't understand. Yes. Your father pays school fees for a school he doesn't agree to. Do you think that's not that wasn't your first, second, or third choice when you wrote BEC? But he paid the school fees. That's not what he wanted. So there is a permissive and acceptable and imperfect will, which is not the perfect will of God. So everything that came after Saul, after this, was not God's perfect will. So in your life also, everything may be working, but that's not God's will for you. Yeah. And you can follow your desires, and God will give it to you. Psalm 106, verse 13. Psalm 106, 13. Psalm 106, 13. They forgot his words, and they waited not for his counsel. Mercy. 14. They lusted exceedingly. How many of you have some desires that are pretty strong? Pretty strong. Yeah. What do you think God's response is to their lust? Look at verse 15. He gave them their request and added leanness in their soul. God will give you what you say you want. He will allow you, but you add a certain pain into the mix. The church is becoming quiet. So, God wants us to search for what is his perfect will. In Exodus 32, Aaron went and gathered all the people and they said they are tired. Moses has left, he's traveled, he has not come back, he has not sent a WhatsApp, he has not called, we've not heard from him, no podcast. So, we've decided that we don't want Moses anymore. Aaron said, no problem, and gathered earrings, melted all the earrings and bracelets and made a golden calf and said, everybody worship. You'd have thought God would have struck them dead immediately. No, no. God was just watching, eating popcorn, he's watching you. So, you learn and notice when the judgment came, Aaron was okay. He said, Pastor, what they said, that's what they want. What will I do? Many times, even me as an imperfect human being, a small boy like me, people come and ask me for advice. I can see that in the advice, they want what they really want. Has it happened to you before? Yeah. So you just say, Charlie, flow. You know, give some one or two verses and then you flow. That's just pray. If that's what you want, God bless you. But that's not what I really think. Mike Murdoch says that his father was a pastor in the town, and his sister went to school and came back and became a stripper in the town. Yes, and said sometimes she'd be drunk and she collapsed, and her father would drive to the car park and go and pick her up. and bring her home and go and drop her at work and like that. Because it's your child. You are God's child. So whatever, if that's what you choose, that's not what you wouldn't have chosen for you to marry that guy. You wouldn't have chosen for you to do that course. But you didn't even seek his face. You were not interested in what God wanted. So you went ahead and God will help you to do it. The church is a bit quiet. So I want us to seek. Now, if we can find what is God's will, number one, we are going to be elevated. Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 1 says, "Shall come to pass if you shall hearken to the voice of the Lord your God and will do all the things that he's saying, I will lift you above all the nations." Look at it, all the nations. You will be lifted up amongst your colleagues when you start to follow the will of God. I'm telling you, in your class, you'll be the best. In your school, you'll be the best. In ministry, you'll be the best. In marriage, you'll be the best. You'll be lifted up when you choose in your heart that I want to follow what God wants for my life. When you choose to decide yourself, you're actually going off. So elevation. Number two, prosperity and pleasure. Job chapter 36, verse 11. Look at the verse. If they obey and serve him, they will spend their days in what? Oh, church, you don't mind me. They'll spend their days in what? And their years in? God has pleasure and prosperity for those who want to obey him. Pleasure. You think God doesn't like pleasure? God created sex. Think about it. He created gold. Everything that is nice, God made it. Everything nice. Only that, I can't explain. But everything that is nice. And God, the Bible says, no good thing will he withhold from you. If it's good, he'll give it to you. And when you choose to serve God, you will spend your time, look at the word, pleasure. God has ordained pleasure for you and it's coming to pass in the name of Jesus. Yes, if you obey him. If you let him choose for you, let him choose your job. Let him choose your husband. Let him choose your wife. Instead of coming to ask us, Pastor, should I marry her? Am I God? I'm not God. So today, I want to share. So I just wanted to explain to you the importance of finding the perfect will. Now, I want to explain to you how you can know. Are you with me? Ephesians 1:9. Having made known unto us the mystery of his will. Everybody say the mystery of his will. God's will is mysterious. You know that Hercules is also the son of God. The story of Hercules is somebody who was the son of God. Zeus was the son of God. So Jesus is like a superhero. Now, the will of God is very mysterious. When you look at Jesus Christ, you ask yourself that if you are sending somebody on earth and you are giving him a superpower, you should have made him like Superman. Should have been able to fly, shoot laser from his eyes, see through walls. No, that would have been much more exciting. And the Pharisee doth accuse him. And Jesus saith unto them, I shall laser you with my eyes. It would have been more powerful. Or Jesus was flying. Yes. And then Jesus went from Nazareth to Galilee and his disciples flew with him. Hey, that would be more powerful. So then you ask, what is Jesus' superpower? His blood. The mystery of God is wonderful. God, his blood is what we will use. In fact, when he was leaving, he left three things. His blood, his name, and his spirit. Wow. These are my superpowers. My name, when you mention it, is powerful. God's things are mysterious. He said, what's the purpose of Jesus Christ? To save the world. Where will he preach? He will only preach in villages, mostly. The only city he will go to, when he goes there, he'll be killed. Village preacher. Imagine, to save the whole world. And Jesus should have come now. Because you'd have been able to reach more with Facebook Live, WhatsApp. By now he has the Jesus TV. I mean, it would be wonderful. But look at the time that he comes in sandals. A carpenter and his friends, the fishermen and a few tax collectors. No radio, no church building, no TV, nothing. And you say that this man should, this how he will win the world. Preach, 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 then die. Die at 33. Jesus should have traveled to Dubai. We should have traveled to, because Thomas was able to go to India. Which means Jesus could have gone to India, Pakistan, Dubai, Qatar. Could have gone to all these places. If anything, Christ should have come to Ghana. I mean, we would have, I don't know what was happening at that time, but I'm sure you could have come to the Ashanti Kingdom and explained a few things to the Ashanti. Yes. But the will of God was, no, stay where you are. So God's will is mysterious. A mystery is something you can't easily see. So one of the difficulties in following God's will is that we don't even know what the will is. So how can we govern our lives or direct our lives to follow what God's will is? Am I talking to anybody this afternoon? I'm already closing. It's already finished. So now, that's where we come to the title of my sermon today, Peace the Umpire. Colossians 3:15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Amen. Now it says, let the peace rule. That word rule is the word umpire or referee or governor or leader. Let peace guide you, or let peace be the referee. The umpire is the referee in tennis. So he blows the whistle. Play on. Stop. Foul. Change. Peace. Peace in your heart. Allow peace to blow the whistle. You see, sometimes, brothers, can I talk to you? You like the girl. See, tell the truth, though. You like the girl. You like it. It's not about you were touched with her outreach skills. No, it's not about that. You like the girl. Now, as you've come to church, and I know some of you have experienced this before, and prophet is preaching, then he starts preaching about maybe marriage or how to choose somebody or things to look out for, and then your heart starts to beat because you feel like there's a problem. How many of you have heard of somebody that it has happened to before? Brothers, wave at me. You've heard of somebody. Not maybe not you. Maybe you are sitting by your beloved, so you can't really. And your heart is troubled. That is the whistle being blown. That peace. Look at it. Let the peace of God. You see, you have to be at peace about decisions. See that you are too worried. You know, recently one of our lay pastors was telling me that he has to come. He said he's a lay pastor. But in every meeting, you see, whenever we start talking about the ministry, he can't sit down. His heart, every time he sends me a text after, you know, PJ, and as I'm preaching now, his heart is beating. It's here, his heart's beating. It's around somewhere, his heart is beating. You see, so peace is trying to blow the whistle. Say, go full time. You are lay, but you're not at peace. Then I have other lay pastors, they are totally at peace. But we are lay. That's what we are. Yeah, that's all. Lay power, we're here. Yeah. So you see, no message affects them. When they are preaching a message, they say, wow, it's good for them. God is helping them. We are supporting them. They should go in Jesus' name. They're okay. So when you are troubled in your heart, that's what Jesus said, my peace I give you. Not as this world gives you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So when God is guiding you, God uses peace to let you know that this is it or this is not it. So when you are very troubled, the boy has proposed to you. You didn't even let him finish. You say yes. So every time we start talking about, make sure that you seek the will of God. You, as I'm preaching now, your heart is worried and your heart is troubled. Don't come and ask me, Pastor Joshua, so what do you think? I don't know what I think. Follow peace, the umpire. Peace, the umpire. What should I do? So which master should I? I don't know which master you should do. Well, how is your heart feeling? I'm at peace. I remember when I used to work in the bank. I couldn't stay there. No. I'm in a hurry to close Santiago. I mean, by the time that we have to leave is the time that I'll go. I mean, and one day my boss called me and said, you know, and I had one most productive employee a number of times. Yeah, they only give you cake. It's not really. But and he called me and said, I can tell that you have another job. Do you have another job? You're not with us. And I remember once I was talking to Reverend Terry, and he was in Bangor. Where is Bangor? Is that still Liberia? He was in Bangor with Healing Teachers Crusade. And there I was at the bank and I was talking to him. And he said, yeah, you're telling me, PJ, you know, that today the miracles, the manifestations, you know, we are on it and we are moving from town to town. And as I was listening, there I was. And number 8 Canada Square, Canary Wharf, London, typing to clients, sending emails and responding. And I was wondering, am I called? I was troubled. I'm being left behind. What's going on? God is calling me. What am I doing here? I'm telling you. And I called my father. I said, I can't. He said, oh, are you sure? You know, I said, I cannot stay here. And I thought, are you sure you finished? I said, I'm coming. I came immediately because my heart wouldn't allow me to be there. So that's how I knew that God was leading me and God was guiding me. Stop asking me whether you should marry somebody from another church. Why are you so worried about it? Why is your heart always beating? Why do you always feel that people are against you? Why do you always feel that somebody is trying to say something? Nobody is talking to you. The Holy Spirit is unsettling your heart. You see, it's the Holy Ghost that gives peace. Galatians 5:22 says, the fruit of the Spirit is peace. Amen. A fruit of the presence of the Holy Spirit is peace with you. But when you don't have that peace, don't go. Stop asking me, should I go for it or shouldn't go for it? I don't know. I go for it and then, you know, recently my wife did something to me. And I was telling her that. So, is this what you are doing to me? I can't really explain it. But is this how it is? This is what you are doing. I say I love you, I've married you. This is what you are doing to me. I mean, it wasn't that serious, but you know. And she told me, this is what you have. This is what you got. And what you have, this is it. You have to just accept it. Yes. And when you've prayed and you're in the will of God and you have peace, you even accept the bad things. So no, it's true. That's what I've got. My wife, I can't even say this, but there are some things that I accept because I know that this is what God wants for me. This is what God, like when God was thinking of me, this is what he wanted. And no matter what happens, God wanted me to go through this because I prayed. But there are some people in marriages, you're not sure whether it's right or wrong. Maybe I should have. And you're actually in the imperfect will of God. But God is still helping. You see, the prodigal son told his father, I'm leaving you, daddy. And daddy said, you are leaving me? You don't want to be under my house? You don't want my advice? You don't want to have anything to do with me? You think you don't need me anymore? You think you are wiser than me? No problem. Not only can you go, wait, let me take half of what I have and sponsor your foolishness. I will pay for you to go and waste your life. Yes, that's God. That's how God is. He said, this is what you want to marry. God will even give you money for the wedding. Oh, yes, maybe you've not met him. The Lord is a shepherd, though. Psalm 23, verse 1. He's a shepherd. He will give you whatever you want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to do what? Green pastures. Leadeth me beside them. He restored my soul. He led me to all these wonderful locations. Green pastures, rivers, restoration of soul. Then suddenly, yea though, who walked? Was I led there? No. I took myself and I went to walk in the valley of the shadow of death. And what did the shepherd do? He just hold your hand. I'm here with you. You've gone to put yourself in the unfortunate situation of being surrounded by your enemies. I'll cook some food. I'll fry some fish for you and prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And in the midst of your disobedience, I'll say, kneel down, and I'll also anoint your head with oil. Surely, goodness and mercy will follow me. What's that? What does that mean? It means you will dwell in the house. So whatever happens, you'll be in church. I'll dwell in the house of God. So there are a lot of people in the house of God who are in the valley of the shadow of death. You went there yourself. So stop coming to ask us. Pastor Joshua, so how will I know? Let peace guide you. You have peace. Why are you worried? Why do you ask so many questions? Every message, you have to text us after to tell us that you want us to know that he's a really good guy. Why are you telling us that? It's too much. Pray about it. You say you want to go and do your master's. Ask the Lord to guide you. When you are reading through the options, you have peace about this. My father chose my university. I brought a list of other universities. He said, no, this one. I have peace about this one. I'll never forget. I have peace about this one. Go. I wouldn't be here today if you hadn't chosen that place. Yeah. Have peace. Let peace guide you. Christians want to take decisions without. Now, Pastor Joshua, how do you activate peace? May I? How do you activate peace? Okay. Philippians 4:5. Activating peace. Tell your neighbor, activating peace. Let your moderation be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. 6. Be careful, or I like the verse that says, be anxious for nothing. Don't be worried about that word. Careful is not our careful. It means to be worried. Don't be worried, agitated, anxious. That's how you are when you come and ask us.
I don't know. So my mother says I should do master. My mother says, one of our pastors came to me and he said, his father, he said he's been called to full-time ministry. His father says he's won the visa lottery. He should go to America. But he doesn't, he said, if he even thinks of him in America, he can't, his heart, he doesn't want it. I said, ah, follow your heart. I should tell you that don't go to America. Hey, so that in 10 years time, you come and tell me that what? By now, my children will be speaking slangs. I can't give you that advice. Do not be anxious about anything. Look at it. But in every situation, every Christians have to stop asking human beings for answers and start asking God for answers. In every situation. What school should I go to? What course should I do? Should I marry her? Should I not marry her? Which church should I go to? Who should be my friend? Should I stay in Ghana or I should go abroad? Should I live in East Legon or I should move to Medina? Should I go to UPSA? Should I go to Legon? Should I invest in this business deal or I shouldn't? Should I put my money into this or I shouldn't? Should I build here or I should build there or I shouldn't build at all? Should I save or I should give? Should I pay? What should I do? That's how you know when they are giving offerings. You can't sit down. The money is in your pocket. You have to go. You have to go. It's the heart. That's how God guides you. Stop waiting to hear a voice saying, my son, give the 100 cedis. No. A voice has to guide you. A voice speaking to your heart. The voice speaks to your heart. For with the heart, man believes. So faith which comes by hearing is actually received in the heart. So you hear with your heart. God wants to direct you by your heart. So look at it. Go back. Philippians 4:6. And give me King James. Now it says, but in everything with prayer. No, there are three, or I'll say four aspects to this verse. Number one is prayer. Pray about it. You know, I use this verse in my, never tell your neighbor, don't copy what he's about to say. Don't tell your neighbor, don't. I had a dissertation to write, 12,000 words, final year. And I kept saying, I'll do it. And it was due on Wednesday. And it was Sunday night. I've come home from church. And I don't know the question. You understand? Yes, I don't know the question. That's why I said, don't follow me. And I asked, have you ever had coursework you can't sleep? Has that happened to you before? Like, as you're sleeping, oh, man. It's like you can't rest. Your heart is beating. You know that they're going to check it soon. And you're trying to think of it. How will I do it? Or should I try and go and beg the lecturer? I don't know what. I've never been to you before. Yeah. So I couldn't sleep. So around almost 3 a.m., just before 3 a.m., I woke up. And this verse was on my heart. Yeah, don't be anxious. No matter whether it's your fault, not your fault, you should have. No. Be anxious for nothing. In everything. Number one, prayer. I prayed for 1 hour. Then I saw supplication. I didn't understand. So I had to go and look for it. That word supplication means to beg, to petition, to necessitate, to anuma. Yeah, it's a different level of prayer. There is a type of cry that stops God. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. There's a type of, you see, in Luke 18, 34, 35, Jesus was walking by the city. And then the blind man, Bartimaeus, shouted, Jesus! And the Bible says he heard that Jesus was passing. Luke 18, 35. Yeah. A blind man begging. The Bible says Jesus was walking by and the man heard that Jesus Christ was passing. The man heard that Jesus was passing. And he knew who Jesus was. Because you may be blind, but you know your Jesus. You may be a sinner, but you know your Jesus. So in everything, no matter how bad you are, what is going on in your life, in everything with prayer. So the man shouted. And I like the scripture, because the scripture says, and Jesus stood. There's a lot of people who shout, but there's a certain cry. That's supplication. That says Jesus stood and commanded for him to come. Jesus stood. What is the problem? There are certain prayers that make Jesus stop what he's doing. He was going somewhere. He wasn't even going into the city. He was passing by. Bible says, look at Jesus stood. They say, where is that guy come? There are certain prayers we have to start praying in our rooms. You see, girls, thank you for the nice voice that you give us. But in your room, you have to learn how to gather your skirt. And pray a certain prayer that makes Jesus stand.
So Jesus asked him, he said, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus asked him, "What will you have me do? What do you want? Say what you want." That's supplication. God wants us to pray. So I didn't understand the word. I had to go and study. Then I prayed for another hour. Instead of going to write my, don't follow me. So I prayed for another hour. Then the third one, Philippians 4:6 said, with thanksgiving. Take me back. Philippians 4:6. With thanksgiving. Make your request known. That's why Jesus asked him, what do you want? But you have to say what you are asking for. God, I want to know whether I should do this or this. Oh God, choose for me. What do you want? Just show me the way. Supplication and thanksgiving. You begin to thank God. The Bible doesn't say we should thank God for everything. No. It says in all things. Not for all things. In all things. So no matter what's going on, you have to be in a state of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is a part of prayer. So the Bible says, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. Now, Pastor Joshua, when I've done all this, what happens? Verse 7. And the peace of God. That's how you activate peace. After you've prayed for something, look for the peace. If you feel troubled, it means you move away from here. I feel peace when I move away. I feel peace when I miss, I have to move away. I feel peace when I stay, it means I have to stay. I feel peace about Lagos, it means I have to go to Lagos. I feel peace about London, I have to go to London. I feel peace about Sierra Leone, I have to go there. I feel troubled about staying in Ghana, I have to leave here. I don't know where, but I have to leave. That's it. The peace. Now notice, which passes understanding. A lot of people think God doesn't think. Somebody once told me, let's put the Bible aside and talk about common sense. A lot of people feel that God's things are not like logical. They are more spiritual, and God is not really a logical person. But Psalm 55:8, Isaiah 55:8, it says, my thoughts, look at it, 55:8, Isaiah 55:8, my thoughts, I think, God, I don't think, I have thoughts, but they are not your thoughts. Neither are my ways. Next verse. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. High. So the peace doesn't have to make sense. That's what I'm showing you. Philippians 4:7 says, the peace doesn't, my thoughts are not your thoughts. It does not make sense to your small human mind. 1 Corinthians 1:21 says, the foolishness of God is wiser than men. When God is a fool, he's wiser than you. Look at it. 1 Corinthians 1:21. Try to keep up. For after that, in the wisdom of God, it pleased God that by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Yeah, but somewhere in that chapter it says the foolishness of God is wiser than men. Find it for me. The foolishness of God is wiser than men. God's wisdom is high. So you may not have peace. You know, Daddy always says when he came full time, he had peace. He left being a doctor to being a pastor of people in a classroom of a church that doesn't take offering. Does it make sense? But the peace of God passes understanding. It passes understanding. So when you allow the peace to lead you, it doesn't have to make sense. Ah, look at it. The foolishness, 125. The foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God is stronger than men. God wants to guide you by his peace. So I'm teaching you today, peace, the umpire, is guiding you and transforming your life. If you follow it, it leads to happiness. So I want you to learn how to pray. Learn how to be in a room praying for the will of God. I remember once I asked Prophet a question. I said, we have started Town Church for 2 weeks. And I said, so what should we do? Can we make the church grow? What should we preach about? And he asked me, he was getting into his car, he asked me, don't you have the Holy Spirit? Pray about it. I don't know. I don't know what you should do. You have to pray. Then he told me, if you don't learn how to pray for yourself, you'll never do a ministry. You have to learn how to ask God, what should I do? What should I do next? What should I say? Where should I go? Holy Spirit, guide me. Holy Spirit, lead me. Holy Spirit, show me the way. Without that. And so I want us to learn how to be in a room in the night with music in the back. That's why we send you First Love Worship. Yeah. If you don't have it, you should ask the nearest pastor for First Love Worship. Yeah. Because songs make God speak. Isaiah 30:29. Look, you have a song. In the night, when it's in the night, you have a song. When a holy solemnity is kept, and gladness of heart, as when one goeth with a pipe to come into the mountain of the Lord, to the mighty one of Israel. What's going to happen in verse 30? And the Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard. The Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard. You are going to hear God's voice. You are going to hear God's direction. God is going to show you what to do as you seek him in the night. Learn how to pray in the night. When peace leads you, good things are coming. Isaiah 55 verse 12. When peace leads you, great and good things are coming. I'm closing. Isaiah 55. You will go out with joy and be led forth with what? Peace. And the mountains and the hills shall, they will be singing for you. And all the trees of the field will clap for you. People will clap and sing for you. When you allow God to lead you, when you allow God to decide for you, and when you allow God to choose for you. God doesn't call you to reduce you. God's version is not a lower and a lesser version. They'll clap for you. They'll sing for you. When you let God choose for you, God's husband is better than your husband. If I had chosen a wife for myself, I'll hit a wall. God's choice is better than your choice. God's choice of a job for you, only higher. You know, I always remember Madame X's testimony. She said, the prophet told her, she had two job options. The prophet said, not this one, this one. Not this one, this one. When God chooses, he said the other one looked like a lower one. That's rather, the trees will clap for you. The mountains will sing. Be led by peace. Be guided by peace. God's choice doesn't reduce you. Where you think you are trying to get to, God will get you there faster. Yeah. You know, the Bible says they thirsted not while he led them. When you do his will, he'll be with you. And he leads you. He will lead you, choose for you. He'll guide for you. And you will never thirst. Jesus was beaten, crown in his head, in his thorn of crowns in his head, nails in his palms, whipped on his back, pierced to the side. Never complained. You know that? There was no complaint. Never said, Ajay, you are beating me. No. Never said, Lord, make them stop. No. Never said, when they spat on him, took off his clothes in front of his friends and family and humiliated him, didn't complain. There's only one complaint Jesus ever made in all of his torture. My God, why have you forsaken me? 3 verses later, he gave up the ghost. He doesn't want to be here without the presence of God. God, do you understand what I'm saying? Yes. Jesus didn't want to exist on this earth. That was his complaint. Beat me, kill me, but don't take your presence away from me. God wants to guide you by his presence. The psalmist said, you shall guide me by your counsel and afterwards receive me into glory. Glory awaits those who are guided by the counsel of God. God doesn't choose for you to make you lesser or make you... And you think God doesn't know what is a nice girl, a nice boy. God doesn't know what is a good job. God doesn't know what is a good place to live. People think God's things are only torture. No, God wants to lift you up. God, I'm higher than I was. When I came, since I come to serve God, I'm higher than what I was. Oh yes, I can never go back. God wants to lift you up. And God wants to bless you. So choose the will of God. Choose to follow what God says. You know, Peter went fishing after Jesus died. Somebody, God has called you to be a pastor, the rock, the founder of the church. You've closed. Yesterday, I was driving in Danfa, and I saw a Catholic church, and I said to myself, this Apostle Peter's branch in Danfa, mighty church. He's gone fishing, of course. Because sometimes you think you know what is good for you. You think you know. You think you know. But God's choice, Satan's work is to keep you from God. To keep you off the path that God wants for you. But the Bible says the steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. So I pray for you. Hear the voice of God. Be guided by peace. May the trees clap for you. May the mountains and hills sing for you. May you be elevated. May you live your days in prosperity and pleasures. And may God bless you as you follow his will. In Jesus' name. Stand to your feet. And I believe we all have something on our hearts that we need to know God's will for. And I believe this is a good time to begin to pray. Just a beginning. But lift your hands and say, Lord, show me or guide me. Show me. Choose for me. Decide for me. Decide for me. Decide for me. decide for me. Choose my wife, Lord. Choose my beloved. Choose my husband, Lord. Choose my job. Show me what to pay for and what not to pay for. Choose my friends, Lord. Choose my future, Lord. Choose my course, Lord. Choose for me, Lord. Lead me, Lord. I will follow. Lead me, Lord.
I will go.
Lift your hand, say, you have called.
You have called me.
I will answer.
I will answer.
Lead me, Lord.
I will.
Church, sing it like you mean it. Lift your hands and declare, lead me, Lord. Satan on your will. Lift your hands and surrender to him. Tell him, Lord, I surrender. I want your will for my life. I want what you want. I want to move by faith and not by sight. I want to trust in your word. I want to trust in your will. For it's only. Lift your hands, sing it, and surrender to his will.
Your will.
Time to be pleasing you. sing it as a prayer to be pleasing.
To be pleasing you.
If you try to sing it, church, sing it to you. This is all I really want to do.
This is all I really want to do.
I want to please you, Lord.
To be pleasing.
I want my life to be pleasing.
You.
I want you to smile on me, Lord. I'll spend my days serving you and pleasing you, Lord.
This is all I really want to do.
One very last time. To be pleasing.
To be pleasing you.
Come on, church, sing it.
Pleasing.
This is all
I really want to do.
Some of you are being freed from decisions you couldn't take. You are free to walk away from relationships. You are free to walk away from those decisions that put you outside the will of God. You are free. What a blessing. Father, we thank you. Show us your will. Show us the way. Lead and we will follow, Lord. We give our lives to you, our hearts to you. And we choose your will. In Jesus' name I pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed. You're here today, you don't know Jesus as your Lord, your personal Savior. Pastor, pray with me. I do not want to go to hell. I know in my heart, I don't have the relationship I should have with Jesus. And I want to make things right. I would like to give my life to Jesus Christ this afternoon. I want Him to change my life. I want to be close to Him. And I want to live as a real Christian. I grew up in a Christian home. I call myself a Christian, but I know in my heart, should I die today? I'm not sure if I'll go to heaven or if I'll go to hell. And I just want to be sure. I came to church today and I feel the Holy Spirit troubling my heart. And I want to allow peace to guide me to the altar to find salvation. If you're here like that, lift up your right hand high above your head. Today is a good day to be saved. Today is a good day to rededicate your life to Jesus Christ. Today is a good day to come home. Lift your right hand high above your head and wave and say, I choose Jesus today. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lift up your right hand. I choose Jesus today. I need salvation. I want the blood of Jesus to make me a new person. You've lifted up your right hand. Do one more thing for me. Walk all the way to the front. I want to pray with you. I see all the hands. But come to the altar. Everybody bow your heads, congregation as well. Repeat this prayer. Heavenly Father, I come to you today just as I am. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Have mercy on me. Forgive me. Write my name in the book of life. One day, I'm coming to heaven to be with you. Come into my heart. Be the Lord and master of my life. Say, Satan, I will no longer serve you. From today, I belong to Jesus. From today, I'm born again. From today, I have a new life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, Amen. Hallelujah. I have this book. The prophet of this church is Bishop Dagwood Mills, and he asked me to give you this book, How to Be Born Again and Avoid Hell. It's 77 pages long, 77 blessings. And I know God is going to transform your life through this book. So when you see him, say thank you. He'll be around next week, so make sure you're here, you can see him. And I know your life will never be the same. Amen. Right after church, we want to meet you right under the red banner where the beautiful ladies are waving. We're going to move all of them and let you sit there. So come with your book. It shows that you're part of this group. And we're going to have a short meeting with you. Your life will never be the same. Amen. You may be seated. Congregation, please take your seats. And can we have communion?
Spirit, we are.
Which also I delivered unto you. This is Paul speaking, and he said, the Lord revealed to him that in the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. The body of Christ. After the same manner, also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. Verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show the Lord's death until he comes. The Lord's death means our sins are forgiven. The Lord's death means our bodies are healed. The Lord's death means we have a new life. The blood of Jesus.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross.
The emblem of suffering. Love that old cross,
and I love that old cross,
where the dearest and best,
where the dearest and best,
for a world of sinners like you and me. Sacrifice. We remember you and we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. And the church said, amen.